Ahmet Aykaç, İzmir Katip Çelebi Üniversitesi Mühendislik ve Mimarlık Fakültesi'nde öğretim üyesi olarak çalışmaktayım. Bugünkü oturumumuzda ilginizi çekeceğinden emin olduğum çok güzel sunumlar bulunmakta. Şimdi bir de İngilizce olarak katılımcılarımıza hitap etmek istiyorum. Hepiniz oturumumuza katıldığınız için teşekkür ederim. Dear participant, welcome to our fifth International Student Science Symposium. This year, the symposium will held as online as we did last year due to the COVID-19 pandemics. I hope you will enjoy all the sessions. All topics are really interesting and quite effective topics. This year, which is held during the 21st and 22nd of May 2021, will be completely online, and at the same time, you will have chance to record or follow our all presentation through YouTube as well. Now, I would like to briefly introduce you myself to you. This is Assistant Professor Dr. Ahmet Aykaç. I'm going to be chair of this session. During the session, if you get face to face with any problem, please do not hesitate to contact us. During the sessions, please keep in mind that you have 15 minutes limited time. So do your presentation, complete your presentation maximum within 12 minutes. And so you will have chance to answer some questions during the last 3 minutes. In total, you will have 15 minutes. Please keep in mind that being on time during the online symposiums are really important. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much for attending our conference. Değerli katılımcılar ve özellikle değerli yazarlar, lütfen 15 dakikalık sürenizin olduğunu ve bu süre zarfında hem sunumunuzu yapmanız hem de sorulacak sorulara cevap vermeniz gerektiğini unutmayınız. Bu kapsamda sunumunuzu yaklaşık 10-12 dakika içerisinde tamamlamanızı, geri kalan sürenizde etkili bir şekilde soru cevap kısmına ayırmanızı tavsiye etmekteyiz. Şimdiden keyifli ve başarılı bir sunum diliyorum. Hepinize tekrar hoş geldiniz diyorum. Teşekkürler. Dear participant, so now it's 2:30 and we are ready for starting with the presentation. I'd like to introduce you the first presenter, Ms. Ala Cihat. She's going to present her presentation, which is graphene-based Scotley junction with highly doped semiconductor. Dear Dr. Cihat, you are here. Welcome to our symposium. Are you ready for your presentation?
Thank you so much, Doctor. Yes, I am ready.
Thank you. So let's get started. Please start your presentation.
May I start now? Can you hear me?
Yes, please.
Okay. Thank you so much. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much. It's a huge pleasure for me to be here. This is my third time or fourth time I'm participating in this International Student Science Congress. My name is Ala Cihat, and I am awarded a PhD degree 2 months ago. So I would like to share with you a part of my PhD study. And title, my presentation title is Graphene-Based Schottky Junction with Highly Doped Semiconductor. So I'm going to start my presentation with giving the outline, which is I'm going to start with the aim of the study and what is chemical vapor deposition method to produce the graphene, and then what is Schottky junction solar cell. And then I'm going to move to the fabrication of the graphene silicon solar cell. The next section will be the result and major findings in this study. And then I'm going to conclude my presentation with the conclusion and references. So first, the aim of this study is to produce high quality graphene layer using chemical vapor deposition method, and then to fabricate the graphene on silicon Schottky junction with a top window design using highly doped semiconductor. Chemical vapor deposition method is a leading approach to synthesis of graphene sheet with high quality, low defects, and good uniformity graphene of sheet. It's normally used, this technique used to synthesis of graphene that's used in application of electronics and sensing and this type of application. Graphene is grown by the decomposition of carbon atoms come out of a precursor hydrocarbon gas at high temperature around 1000 to 1050 on a transition metal. It could be nickel foam or copper foil or nickel foil, and subsequently. After that, the carbon atoms will arrange themselves in sp2 hybridization form. Schottky junction is simply, we can define the Schottky junction as a junction between a metal and semiconductor. In our study, we use the metal, we use the graphene as a metal, which is known as a semi-metal material. So here we can see simply we have, here is the metal side, here is the semiconductor. In our study, we used N-type silicon semiconductor. So simply when sunlight shine on this junction, only photons, sun photons with the energy larger than the energy gap of the semiconductor can release and extract the valence electron from valence band. And so it will be moved free within the conduction band. So that means we generate an electron hole pair. These pairs are separated by built-in field, the built-in electric field. And this field will work to separate the generated electron hole pair by drifting the electron to the semiconductor and the hole to the metal side. Graphene on semiconductor Schottky junction, since the graphene has a large surface area, high carrier mobility, and almost zero band gap, so it makes it an ideal material in Schottky junction. Using a graphene in such a kind of solar cell can guarantee two parameters, first as a transparent electrode and second as an active layer. The efficiency of this kind of solar cell has been increased working on some factors, some parameters such as texturing silicon substrate, applying multi-layer of graphene, and using doping operation for the graphene itself. So we use chemical doping and using anti-reflection coating on the top of the surface of the solar cell. And it could be applying a passivation layer between the graphene and the semiconductor. In my study, the fabrication step used to fabricate, to produce this graphene silicon is include some steps. So first step was silicon substrate cleaning route. In our study, we used N-type silicon with orientation 100, highly doped phosphor doped silicon. And the thickness of the wafer was 500 micrometer coated with a 300 nanometer of silicon dioxide. So first step was using cutting the silicon wafer with using diamond pen with a dimension 1 by 1 centimeter. And then we started the cleaning steps, which cleaning routes include like general cleaning with acetone and methanol, and then particle removal and metal contamination removal. And the last step was etching the silicon dioxide layer we have on the silicon. So we used hydrofluoric acid to etch the entire silicon dioxide, and we checked the fully etching of the silicon dioxide by checking the hydrophobic of the silicon surface, as you can see in this photo. The next step was thermal evaporation for the back contact of the cell, since our silicon are ready, so cleaned and ready, so we can first deposit the backside metal. So we use thermal evaporation system, and two different shadow masks have been designed to this in this study. So the metal, the back contact metal, we deposit 5 to 150 nanometer of chromium and silver. As you can see here, we place the four cells here, and this is the shadow mask. So here we deposit the back contact. And after that, it was time to synthesis the graphene. In this study, we use CVD synthesis. So simply, CVD synthesis is, first we use a commercially copper foil with a thickness 25 micrometer, and 2 by 2 centimeters square were placed in a CVD furnace for annealing step, and the temperature was increased to 1070 with the flowing of hydrogen and argon gases for 2 hours. And later we used a chemically etching, used a ferric chloride to etch the front surface, or the surface we are working to synthesize the graphene on it. And after that, it placed again in the CVD furnace for a synthesis of monolayer graphene. Again, the copper foil was, the polished copper foil was placed in the CVD furnace, and the temperature 1070 Celsius degree with a flowing different ratio of flowing of hydrogen and argon for 40 minutes. And then 10 SSCM of methane gas was introduced to the chamber inside the furnace for 2 minutes. And later the copper foil with the graphene was fast cooling to the room temperature within a few minutes. The third step was etching the copper foil. Since we have the graphene deposited on the copper foil, in order to protect the graphene before etching the copper, spin coating was used, was protected. PMMA was used by spin coating to protect the synthesis of the graphene. And after that, the copper was etched away using the 0.1 molar of ammonium persulfate and left it for 1 night. So here, the photo here, like once we place the copper with the graphene and with PMMA in the ammonium persulfate, and here next day we can see, this is in a few hours, but next day we can see like only a transparent clear is floating on the surface of the solvent. So the next step is wet transfer of the CVD graphene. Here we have graphene, and it's protected with a PMMA, the polymer layer. So it was washed, rinsed 3 times with deionized water, and then was transferred on the desired substrate, which in our case was N-type silicon, already the back contact metal, we have back contact. So on the front surface, we transfer graphene sheets and left it in vacuum for a few hours. After that, the PMMA was removed by placing or immersing the silicon substrate in a hot acetone for 30 minutes. And here we can see it's hardly visible to check the graphene layer on the front surface. Even with this step, we still have a PMMA residue on the surface of the substrate. Next step was thermal evaporation of the front contact, which we use a different shadow mask to deposit 5 to 50 nanometer of gold, of chromium and gold. Here we can see, here we are covering the active area, which is 0.11 under the shadow mask. And here we deposit the metal frame on the cell. And this is the after depositing the front contact on the front surface, here we still have the graphene. And because in my study, we were not able to use a photolithography technique, so I designed this mask with some gaps here. So these gaps was finally filled with a silver base in a, as a last step. And then we connected the wires to make a circuit. Result, first result was Raman spectroscopy. And here we have like two curve for Raman spectroscopy. First graphene transfer on the copper. We got this result, as you can see, the defect and the thickness layer ratio. And then after we transfer silicon, we transfer graphene on the silicon, and we used a thermal annealing treatment, which we placed the silicon graphene after we removed the PMMA to the CVD furnace with flowing of hydrogen and argon for 2 hours at the temperature of 350 Celsius degree. So here we can see after annealing, almost the defect density was decreased to 0.15, and the thickness layer ratio is 3.49. So that means we improved the annealing step, improved the quality of the graphene, which is considered as a monolayer and high quality graphene. The second image was for a scanning electron microscope, and here we can see the first.
Ala, I would like to remind you that last 2 minutes.
Okay. Here, the first image is for the graphene on the copper foil. We can see, confirm the growth of the smoothness, smooth surface and continuous graphene sheet. The second, after transferring the graphene on the silicon substrate. Here, I just wanted to show you the effectiveness of the annealing step after transferring the graphene. We checked it with AFM, atomic force microscope. So before annealing, we have abundant of this PMMA islands, we call it, on the surface of the graphene. And after annealing, we decrease this, the highest of the island, and the majority like of islands was disappeared. So it was effective, almost 75% of the islands was decreased or was removed. Last result is the IV characteristic of the solar cell. Here we have four cases for before annealing, the efficiency was 0.6, after annealing 0.80, and we doped the graphene, tried once with the nitric acid vapors, we got efficiency 1.9, and doping with the graphene oxide powder or like spin coating was 2.24. So the conclusion, graphene N-type silicon Schottky junction solar cell with a top window structure and an active area 0.11 has been fabricated. High quality monolayer graphene was synthesized by CVD and confirmed by Raman and other characteristic. And two dopants have been used, nitric acid vapor and graphene oxide. And the best results we had was using doped graphene with a graphene oxide dispersion, we got efficiency 2.24. Acknowledgement, I would like to thank DuPont Zeidel University, the Research Center of Fabrication of and Application of Electronic Material. They gave me access to magnetron sputtering deposition, and they also helped me with supporting me with some chemicals. Thank you to Associated Professor Dr. Mustafa Erol. In İzmir Katip Çelebi University, I would like to thank the Central Research Laboratory and Application. I would like to thank Associated Professor Fethullah Güneş for providing me and give me access to his laboratory to do the CVD graphene. And my thanks to Assistant Professor Dr. Ahmed Aykaç for supporting me with some chemicals and material. Thank you so much. In Ege University Solar Energy Institute, I would like to thank Prof. Dr. Ceylan Zafar, who gave me the access to the thermal evaporation system. Here is some of my references, and thank you for your attention. Any questions?
Thank you very much, Ala, for this nice presentation, nice work. Maybe we can have a very short question and answer if you have further question and too many questions, please contact to Ayla directly, because we would like to be on time, as I remind you at the beginning of this session. So if there is any question, very short question, if I receive through the chat, I can ask to Ayla. Okay, thank you so much, Ayla. Now you can stop your sharing, and we are going to move to second presentation. Mm-hmm. Now, İzel Ok is going to present her study, Production and Characterization of Zinc Oxide Chitosan-Based Hydrogel Functionalized by Mesoporous Silica Nanoparticles. I'd like to welcome İzel Ok. If she can hear me, please.
Hello, I can hear you, but I cannot share my screen.
Now I will let you to share your screen.
Yes, here. Hello, my name is. Sorry, can you see my screen yes. now?
We can see.
Okay. Hello. First of all, my name is İzel Ok. I am Master of Science student in Nanoscience and Nanotechnology Department at İzmir Katip Çelebi University. My supervisor is Assistant Professor Dr. Ahmet Aykaç. And today I will talk about the production and characterization of zinc oxide chitosan-based hydrogels functionalized by mesoporous silicon nanoparticles. And First of all, it's my content, and I will talk about what is the hydrogel and mesoporous silicon nanoparticles, zinc oxide chitosan-based hydrogels, and we will paste aim of the study. And then the next section is experimental section. In this section, I will talk about the preparation of mesoporous silicon nanoparticles, zinc oxide nanoparticles, zinc oxide chitosan nanoparticles, and their combination in as hydrogel, and their characterizations, and result and discussion, and finally, conclusion and future perspective. So first of all, what is the hydrogel? Hydrogels are three-dimensional cross-linked soft materials that are composed of large amount of water without dissolving or losing their structure. Owing to this high water content property, hydrogels exhibit excellent biocompatibility, the capability to easily encapsulate hydrophilic drugs, and decrease the risk of drug denaturation and aggregation upon exposure to organic solvents, as well as they can act like tissues. And the first picture, we can see how it's look like. And the second picture, we can see the crosslinks. Hydrogels have chemical crosslinks and physical crosslinks. So we can see the structure here. And mesoporous silicon nanoparticles. There are many materials are used as drug carriers, such as liposomes, polymeric nanoparticles, dendrimer-based nanomaterials. Among of them, mesoporous silicon nanoparticles are considered as promising carrier, owing to their high thermal and chemical stability, good biocompatibility, large surface area, controllable mesoporous size. Also, MSNs have the ability to boost both the mechanical strength of the chitosan hydrogel and control the drug releasing time. Here in this picture, the first one, it shows how it's look like, the mesoporous silicon nanoparticle, and you can see the pores. And the second picture shows that how it is carrying the drugs. Zinc oxide chitosan-based hydrogels. Chitosan is one of the most widely naturally occurring polymer used to produce hydrogel. It shows excellent biocompatibility, biodegradability, low toxicity, antimicrobial activity, and that's why they are using for biomedical application, for example, as chitosan-based hydrogel. On the other hand, chitosan-based hydrogels have low mechanical strength because of the high water content and loose three-dimensional network. Among the problem is that another problem is that the releasing time of small drug molecules such as antibiotics from chitosan hydrogels cannot be satisfactory. In order to overcome these problems, chitosan is supported with other materials. In this context, we supported chitosan with zinc oxide nanoparticles. Zinc oxide is a metal oxide that plays important role in medical application owing to its rich range of morphologies, like such as nanorod, nanowires, nanoflowers, or spherical, and UV protection ability, and synthesis flexibility, non-toxicity, biocompatibility, antibacterial properties, and efficient photocatalytic and photo-oxidizing ability, and good chemical and thermal stability properties. So, aim of the study. In this study, we aim to create zinc oxide chitosan-based hydrogels reinforced with mesopore silicon nanoparticles. To address that, MSNs are able to enhance the gel mechanical strength of the hydrogel, and zinc oxide nanoparticles are able to increase the antibacterial properties of the hydrogel. And as I said before, chitosan has already antibacterial properties, and we want to increase that antibacterial properties by using zinc oxide nanoparticles. Experimental section. We use STAP, TOS, ammonium hydroxide, and ethanol to synthesize mesopore silicon nanoparticles, and chitosan, acetic acid, zinc acetate dihydrate, and sodium hydroxide to synthesize zinc oxide nanoparticles, and zinc oxide chitosan-based nanoparticles and hydrogel. Preparation of mesopore silicon nanoparticles. In this experiment, we mixed the TOS, STAP, ammonium hydroxide, and ethanol in the water solution. After the reaction, we obtained white precipitation, and we washed them and keep dry. And this picture shows us what is happening in the reaction. For example, this structure is called swelling shrinking mechanism. It is supported by the synthesis of mesopore silicon nanoparticle, with STAP as a structure directing agent and TOS as a silicon source. STAP was firstly dissolved in a water solution. After TOS addition, it was solubilized in STAP hydrocarbon cores, thus enlarging the micelles. When TOS within the STAP hydrocarbon cores was completely consumed, the micelles shrunk and became smaller in size, and we have mesopore silicon nanoparticles. Preparation of zinc oxide nanoparticles. First of all, we dissolved zinc acetate dihydrate in water, and then we had sodium hydroxide the drop wise until pH is 11. And the solution was stirred for 2 hours, and then we washed it and kept dried. Preparation of zinc oxide chitosan-based nanoparticles. We dissolved already prepared zinc oxide in acetic acid, and then we add the chitosan inside the solution, and it was stirred in sonicator for 20 minutes, and we add sodium hydroxide again dropwise and until pH 11 again, and keep stirring for three hours, and then it was washed and kept dried overnight. Preparation of zinc oxide chitosan and MSN-based hydrogel. MSNs were added into the 1 molar acetic acid at room temperature. And then zinc oxide chitosan powder was dissolved this acetic acid suspension for 24 hours. The viscose solution was transferred into petri dishes and dried overnight. And the semi-dried hydrogels were further dried in an oven. And characterization, we did FTR, DLS, and some characterization for nanoparticles and swelling test for hydrogel. Here we have a FTR graphic for MSN, and we can see OH bonds and JH bonds, carbon-hydrogen bonds, and silica bonds here. And this graphic belongs to Kytosan hydrogel, and here again we have OH bonds and carbon bonds, carbon hydrogen bonds, and also we have nitrogen and oxygen bonds. And now we have DLS analysis result. According to DLS analysis, the size of mesopore silicon nanoparticles is approximately 400 nanometers, while the size of zinc oxide nanoparticles is approximately 120 nanoparticles, nanometers. And as we can see, we obtain monodisperse particles. Here we have some analysis result. The first picture belongs to mesopore silicon nanoparticles, and the second one belongs to zinc oxide nanoparticles. And again, we can see the particle size here. And swelling test. For swelling test, the samples of about 0.1 gram of dried hydrogels were immersed in distilled water at room temperature for defined period of time, and samples were weighed, and the swelling ratio was calculated using the following equation. And this equation S is swelling ratio, and WS is the weight of the swollen hydrogels. WD is weight of the dried hydrogels, and we can see this graphic, and we can say that the hydrogels with zinc oxide and MSN was swelling more controllable. So we can use this kind of hydrogels for drug delivering systems as drug carriers, because we can control their swelling ratio, and also we can control their releasing time of the drugs in these hydrogels. And conclusion of future perspective, our investigations and studies will be continued with more alternative parameters and characterizations. However, given that data, we can say that zinc oxide chitosan-based hydrogels reinforced with mesopore silicon nanoparticles have potential to be improved in terms of mechanical strength and antibacterial analysis. Unlike the chitosan hydrogels without MSNs and zinc oxide. The result of study will lead to further investigations related to drug delivery systems and my references. And thank you for your attention. And also I would like to say thank my supervisor, Assistant Professor Dr. Ahmet Aykaç, to be such an energetic, understanding, supportive and reachable person. And he's always supporting me. And also I would like to say thank you, thanks my teammates who we are working together at Aykaç Research Lab. So if you have any question, please.
Thank you very much, Izel, for the nice and effective presentation, and as well as you use your time quite good, quite nice. So now, if you have any question, we can get one or two short questions. Now it's your turn, dear students.
I have a question, sir.
Ms. Mohamed, yes. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you very much for the presentation, and it's very interesting. Just to not take more time, I'd like to know about the difference of sizes. Did you compare the sizes of the nanoparticle, like for the zinc oxide and the chitosan and the MSN, what will be the difference of size while doing the same characterization one? And while the second question is while do the synthesis of the nanoparticle, you have used sodium hydroxide. What was the main purpose, or what was the role of the sodium hydroxide? At the same time, in the results, we have seen like there is some nanoparticles, and the size was like 400 nanometers. So 400 nanometers, it can be included like it's a nanoparticle, or it's more than nanoparticle. Please, thank you.
First of all, DLS analysis and SEM analysis result can be different because SEM is kind of, you know, photograph, and when you actually SEM analysis, size of in the SEM analysis is more trustable. And because in DLS, it is kind, it depends on the reflection, and that's why if you want to learn the exactly how it's what kind of size, we should check the SEM analysis. And actually, I can't explain it correctly, but it is. It is normal, and if because they are different, it is normal the DLS and SEM analysis. Actually, I don't know what is exactly. And sodium hydroxide, your second question. This reaction depends on the electrostatic interaction. And when we add the sodium hydroxide, we are increasing the pH. And when we increasing the pH, the electrostatic charges are changing on the silicon on the setup and TOS, and they are we are making them more positive and negative, and this and in this case they are connecting each other. And for example, if you want to make this interaction, you should you should decrease the pH. And for this, we are using the ammonium carbonate. I think I'm not sure exactly. And when we add it, we are doing the pH to neutralize, and we are breaking the bonds. And then we can obtain the pore size and pores. I don't know. I can. Is it enough? But
I understood. But I was like curry. Like, is sodium hydroxide is not going to increase? Like, because I think it will be having them some precipitation. It's not going to increase SAR. It's not going to increase the size of the yields. Please.
No, I don't. I think no, it isn't, because actually it is not important. It is sodium hydroxide. For example, you can use the potassium hydroxide. It is important. Then you have to increase the pH. And if you check the literature, you can see some papers. In some papers, they use the potassium hydroxide also.
Thank you both of you, and I think now it's time to move the next presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you, Izel. Now we are going to present you Gülperi Feyza Yavuz. Welcome to our symposium, Gülperi Feyza Yavuz. She's going to present graphene titanium dioxide modified PMMA nanofiber synthesis with electrospinning technique. Welcome, and can you hear me, Feyza?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead and please continue with your presentation.
Hello everyone, my name is Feyza Yavuz, and I'm a master student in Materials Science and Engineering Department at İzmir Kadir Çelebi University. And this is our topic, the graphene and titanium dioxide modified PMMA nanofiber synthesis with electrospinning technique. First of all, I will briefly talk about the nanofibers and their usage areas with our motivation. After that, I will continue with our nanocomposite structure with synthesis and characterization. Nanotechnology includes the use of nanomaterials and represents one of the newest efforts in science in general. And nanofibers are an example of nanomaterials that are mostly produced by electrospinning. And these electrospun membranes or filters have properties like higher porosity, interconnected pores, and lightweight and high surface area. And you can see the other properties on the chart. And here, some application areas are written below. For environmental engineering and biotechnology, technology can be used as a filter or membranes. For the energy industry, can be used as a solar and fuel cells, as a chemical and biological protection sensor in defense industry, and for the healthcare, can be used for drug delivery and tissue engineering. In this study, we aim that to produce a nanofiber filter mechanism combined with the graphene and titanium dioxide superior properties. And it's widely studied in developing area. We use graphene and titanium dioxide as a reinforcing material. And our methods are provides us to achieve a high quality and low cost nanofiber synthesis. And these advanced materials also provide a wide usage area for composite structures because of their easy to adaptability. The objective of the present study is a synthesis of graphene and titanium dioxide modified PMMA nanofibers with high hydrophobic properties and with fine diameters. To understand the effect of different concentrations of graphene and titanium dioxide with the different rates of PMMA, solutions were tested on produced nanofibers. First of all, for the filter mechanism, we try to demonstrate that the graphene's effect on nanofiber. Thus, we can ensure the effectiveness of all parts on the nanofiber and nanofiber synthesis step by step. And for the electrospinning process, for first step, we use the graphene and polymer solution at the desired rates. And for the second step, we will combine this solution with titanium dioxide nanoparticles. Unfortunately, due to the pandemic, we fell behind the schedule and we couldn't complete the second step of this study. And now let's talk about what is graphene and why we using in this project. And graphene is a one atomic, two-dimensional hydrophobic material. It consisting of a sp2 hybridized carbon atoms. And graphene improves the mechanical strength, flame resistance, conductivity, antibacterial activity, resistance to abrasion, and UV protection. But also it prevents the diffusion of heat and gases. Based on these features, graphene may help to improve the properties of materials combined with. For this study, we combined the graphene with the polymetal methacrylate polymer for nanofiber synthesis. And we use polymetal methacrylate as a matrix material for the electrospun fibers. PMMA is a transparent and synthetic resin produced from a polymerization of metal methacrylate. And this biocompatible polymer also compatible with graphene. It shows a high impact strength and lightweight and fracture resistance and exhibits a favorable processing conditions. And then we use a titanium dioxide. Titanium dioxide is one of the most important metal oxide semiconductors. It shows a non-toxic and chemically stable features. And its applications in a wide range of fields, such as solar cells, photocatalysis, lithium ion batteries, and hydrogen energy production. And however, the photo efficiency of titanium dioxide is limited limited by the, its large band gap energy. And the titanium dioxide and graphene composites are a potential material to improve the photo efficiency of titanium dioxide. If we mention the technique, we used electrospinning method to obtain a graphene and PMMA nanofibers. Electrospinning is a nanofiber production process from a polymer solution with the application of a strong electric field. And with this process, the polymeric nanofiber can be produced in desired size. And electrospinning is a simple and versatile method. We can produce a micro or nano sized polymer fibers. And also this method mostly used for the nanofiber production because of its cost effectiveness and ease accessibility. And I put here the electrospinning process that we are used. And in shortly, we synthesized the CVD-based graphene foam and we dispersed these graphenes in acetone solution for 24 hours. And then 2.8% PMMA solution were prepared and then mixed for 24 hours again for to create a homogeneous polymer solution. After that, we mixed them in different rates, and you can see the here rates. And for the electrospinning process, we keep the distance between the pump to collector. It means here's pump to collector is 15 centimeter, and we achieved the electrospin nanofibers in 5 hours. And whether the final product shows the desired properties were measured by some characterization methods. And these are scan electron microscopy, contact angle, and Raman spectroscopy. Scan electron microscopy. The nanofibers are shown in the figures. Figure A is indicates the pure PMMA nanofiber, and B is indicates the PMMA nanofiber with graphene. And when we compare the diameters of pure PMMA nanofibers that we take as a reference, and the diameters of graphene modified PMMA nanofibers observed a significant decrease in size. In this way, the mesh and filter mechanism has been reduced and more effective network structure has been created. As you can see in the slide, while pure PMMA nanofiber diameter was 521.
Is your last 5 minutes, please pay attention to the time.
Okay. PMMA nanofiber is 521 nanometer with the usage of graphene, nanofiber diameter decreased to the 98 nanometer. And when we check the other concentrations of graphene, we can say that the size of nanofibers was changed with graphene content. For the contact angle measurements, we can say that the electrospun PMMA and different concentration of graphene PMMA nanofibers show that the hydrophobic behavior of the nanofibers with graphene increased from the 68 degrees to 113 degree. And with the Raman analysis results, we achieved the graphene and PMMA characteristics peaks. And PMMA characteristic peaks is here, and these are graphene peaks, DG and 2D peaks. And conclusion, based on the results that we obtained in this study, The presence of graphene was supported by Raman results. At the same time, according to the results, graphene and PMMA Raman characteristic peaks were observed. And a contact angle measurements obtained from the electrospoon PMMA and graphene PMMA nanofibers showed that the nanofibers hydrophobicity is increased. And according to the measurements utilized from the scanned electron microscopy microscope image, we saw a decrease in the diameter of graphene modified PMMA nanofibers compared to the pure PMMA nanofibers. And we obtained these measurements through the ImageJ program. On the average, the diameter of the pure PMMA nanofibers was known to decrease from a 521 nanometer to 98 nanometer with the addition of graphene. And this condition is result of the increase of charge density. And that generates a higher elongation force to the ejected jets during the electrospinning process. And for future studies, the effect of titanium dioxide content in different concentrations on PMMA fiber will be studied. And this work, which is reference for the future studies, can be developed for use in areas such as wastewater treatment, oil water separation, and kind of air filtration. And finally, I would like to point out that due to the pandemic, we have fall behind our schedule. And therefore, our experiments are still ongoing for the second part of our study. And this is the end of my presentation. Thank you for your attention. I would like to hear if you have questions or suggestions.
Thank you very much, Feyza, for the nice presentation. You're yes, welcome. If there is any question, we can receive a short question from you. So we can continue with the next presentation. Thank you once again, Feyza. Have a nice day. Stay with us. Watch the next presentation. So now, Ezgi Berfin Çeper and Orhan Güney are going to present their study, Synthesis and Application of Self-Healing Nanocomposite Hydrogels Containing Modified Graphene Oxide.
Hello.
Hello.
No, I see. Yeah, can you see?
Yes, we can see. Thank you. Go ahead. Now okay. It's your turn.
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Ezgi Çeper, and I am doing my master's degree at Polymer Science and Technology Department at Istanbul Technical University. Today, I am going to talk about synthesis and applications of self-healing nanocomposite hydrogels containing modified graphene oxide. First of all, I would like to talk about the contents. I will give brief information about what are hydrogels and what are graphene oxide hydrogels. I will give information about my aim of this study, and then experimental section, following by the results and discussion part and conclusion. So hydrogels are three-dimensional cross-linked soft materials that can hold a large amount of water in their swollen state. They can hold solvent about 99% of their mass or volume. They can also be reversibly dissolved and swell up to 1,000 times in their volume, depending of the various external stimuli. Hydrogels have high water content. Their structure is similar to the extracellular matrix. They have tunable chemical and physical properties, and they have good biocompatibility. With these advantages, hydrogels have been used in many applications in biomedicine, such as drug delivery, wound healing, contact lenses, sensors, and water treatments. As we mentioned, hydrogels contain large amount of water, which makes them, which results in poor mechanical properties. When it comes to strength required applications, this weakness should be overcome. To overcome this issue, there are many methods, such as preparing double network hydrogels or triple network hydrogels or topological gels. One strategy is to prepare nanocomposite hydrogels. There are different kinds of nanocomposite hydrogels, such as carbon-based, metal-based, ceramic-based, or polymeric nanoparticles. These nanoparticles provide mechanical strength to the hydrogels, but this is not only with a mechanical strength. They also provide optical, magnetic, self-healing, and conductivity to the hydrogels and make their applications to be brought in other areas. Among different nanoparticles, graphene-based materials are highly introduced. And graphene oxide is a type of graphene material which possesses a large amount of epoxy, hydroxyl, carbonyl, carboxyl group on its surface. And graphene oxide has remarkable properties such as high surface activity, high mechanical strength, and it has easy of processability. And it has large surface area, and it has a rich oxygen-containing functional group. This makes graphene oxide to be functionalized via covalent or non-covalent bonds for further opportunities. As we mentioned, graphene oxide provides mechanical strength to the hydrogels, but it also provides self-healing behavior to the hydrogels. That's why it has been used in self-healing applications. Its high surface area and abundant negative charge groups on its surface makes it favorable to be used in ion absorptions, water treatments, and or toxic removal applications. It also has been used in human monitors detection, sensor, and self-adhesive electrodes. As we mentioned again, graphene oxide can be modified covalently or non-covalently for further applications. The aim of this study is to develop mechanically strength, flexible, self-healable, and conductive hydrogels based on physical and chemical cross-linking of graphene oxide and modified graphene oxide. Vinyl graphene oxide is used in the development hydrogels for the first time in this study. In the literature, there is no example of hydrogels which exhibit self-healing and conductive properties based on electrostatic interaction, where graphene oxide is chemically modified by selenization. In this study, first of all, we produced graphene oxide from graphite. This process by achieved by a modified Hammer's method, as shown in figure. So after the synthesis, we achieved graphene oxide with high functional groups on the surface. After the preparation of the graphene oxide, we prepared different concentrated suspensions to see the effect of the nanoparticle concentration on the hydrogel. After the synthesis of graphene oxide, we modified graphene oxide surface by reactive graphene oxide with metacarloxypropyltrimethoxysilane molecule, which is referred as MPTS in here. This reaction occurred between the hydroxyl groups on the surface of graphene oxide and resulted vinyl modified graphene oxide show vinyl functional groups on the surface. After the modification, we also prepared same concentrated suspensions of vinyl graphene oxide. To prepare hydrogels, we prepared a different concentrated suspensions of both graphene oxide and vinyl graphene oxide. After this preparation of suspensions, we adjust the pH to 10 to avoid any agglomeration behavior of our cationic monomer madde. We use acrylamide as a second monomer. With the help of cross-linking agent disacrylamide, we polymerize the hydrogel at 35 centigrade degree for 24 hours. After the synthesis, we achieve ionic bonds and hydrogen bonds in the structure, and the result of hydrogels are named as in the table. Acrylamide MAPTA hydrogel is our neat hydrogel. Vinyl-based, vinyl graphene oxide-based hydrogel is prepared by the same method, also again by adjusting the pH to 10. Because without adjusting pH to 10, our solution shows agglomeration behavior. And with the help of vinyl addition to the graphene oxide, we also achieved covalent bonds in the structure, which is expecting to be increased in the mechanical strength. For the characterizations, we achieved FTIR spectroscopy, Svenning measurements, and self-healing behavior. FTIR spectroscopy of graphene oxide is showed as red. We see the peak appeared at 1,700, which is characteristic bond of the carbon-oxygen stretching mode of both carboxylic and carbonyl groups of graphene oxide. And after the modification of graphene oxide, we see the peak at 1,600 corresponding to the vinyl groups of the MPTC unit on the sheet, which indicates that carbon-carbon double bonds have been successfully introduced on the surface of graphene oxide sheet. And the further peaks also show us the successful modification of million molecules. For the self-healing measurements, we cut hydrogels in cylindrical form with diameter of 4.5 millimeter and 0.5 centimeter in length, and we placed in a vacuum oven at 60 centigrade degree for about 24 hours to obtain dry specimens. The dried gels were weighted and placed in distilled water with varied pH numbers at 23 centigrade degree until they reach stable point. In this study, we used 3, 7, and 12 pH value by dropping hydrochloride and sodium hydroxide into double distilled water. The mass of hydrogels were noted as function of time and calculated by the equation in the table. In our Svenning measurements at pH 3. So we see that on the while point of the graph, when we introduce vinyl graphene oxide into the hydrogel, hydrogels reached only up to 400 Svenning degree, while graphene oxide hydrogels can up slightly higher than these hydrogels. In acidic medium, most of the carboxylic acids and amine groups of the polymer undergo numerous hydrogen bonding interactions which with functional groups in graphene oxide. This results in shrinking of hydrogel networks and poor Svenning performance.
Last 5 minutes.
Okay. And also, we can see that with increasing the nanoparticle concentrations, the relative Svenning degree decreased as expected. At pH 7, the carboxyl groups are converted into carboxylates at pH 7. This results in electrostatic repulsion between anionic groups in the networks. And this high electrostatic repulsion increases the swelling of the hydrogel. In more basic environments, the swelling capacity of hydrogel was decreased here. This is obvious because in here, the highest swelling degree is only 180. In basic medium, the electrostatic repulsions become weak, which result in decreasing the Svenning capacity of the hydrogels compared to the natural pH. And Here, when we compare the graphene oxide and vinyl graphene oxide contents in the hydrogels, as we can see, the increase in the graphene oxide and vinyl graphene oxide contents slightly decrease the swelling of the hydrogels. And also, we see that in natural conditions, hydrogels achieve higher swelling. For the self-healing behavior, as we mentioned, graphene oxide provides self-healing behavior, which is due to the reversible physical attractions. Here we can see in the picture, there is a slight difference in the surface, which shows our cutoff surface. But this picture was taken after the hydrogels were attached to each other without adding any external agents. They showed a swelling behavior, self-healing behavior. In conclusion, our FDR results demonstrate a successful modification of graphene oxide. In swelling measurements, we saw that increasing the concentration of nanoparticles decreases the swelling degree. And also, in highly basic conditions, hydrogels show lower swelling degree. Both graphene oxide and vinyl graphene oxide based hydrogels shows pH-dependent behavior, which makes them to be a good candidate in also pH-sensitive applications. Further characterization methods will be continued for further investigations, such as more detailed self-healing, and also for conductivity studies. Those are the references. Thank you for your attention and thank you for your participation. I also would like to thank my supervisor, Professor Orhan Güney, for his help during this presentation and thesis.
Thank you very much for participation and thank you very much for the nice presentation. Mm-hmm. We have time for a short question. If there is any question, you can raise your hand or you can directly start to talk. To ask?
Can I ask a question?
Go ahead, please.
Does graphene oxide needs to be biocompatible? Because as far as I know, there are some concerns about the biocompatibility of graphene oxide. And in your study, do you need graphene oxide needs to be biocompatible?
There are many examples in the literature showing that graphene oxide provides biocompatibility to the hydrogels. To be our applications, as you can see, if we are aiming to produce an electrode system to be used in the skin or in tissues, it needs to show a biocompatibility, but otherwise it doesn't need to, but it shows.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for your question.
Is there any other question? If no, I would like to thanks once again for the nice presentation. So now we are going to continue with the next presentation that comes from İzmir Katip Çelebi University again. Now, Gizem Kestane is going to present her presentation. Çinko oksit nanoparçacıklarla katkılandırılarak üretilen felspatik cam seramiklerin karakterizasyonu. I'd like to thank for their contribution and participation. Gizem, hoş geldin. Şimdi sunum sırası sende. Sesini duyamıyoruz.
Merhaba, sesim geliyor mu?
Şimdi geliyor. Teşekkürler.
Teşekkürler. Merhaba, ben Gizem Kestane. İzmir Katip Çelebi Üniversitesi Nanobilim ve Nanoteknoloji alanında yüksek lisans yapıyorum. Danışman hocam, doktor öğretim üyesi Ahmet Aykaç ve eş danışman hocam, doçent doktor Mücahit Sütçü ile beraber çalışıyorum. İçerik, öncelikle sizlere çinko oksit nanoparçacıklar ve felspatik cam seramiklerle ilgili birkaç bilgi vereceğim. Ardından çalışmanın amacı, deneysel çalışmalar içerisinde çinko oksit nanoparçacık sentezi, çinko oksit nanoparçacıklar ile felspatik cam seramik tozunun katkılandırılarak oluşturulması, perlet oluşumu, karakterizasyon çalışmaları ve son olarak da sonuç ve tartışma şeklinde sunumumu tamamlayacağım. Çink oksit nanoparçacıklar. Nanopartiküller boyutları 100 nanometreden küçük parçacıklar olarak adlandırılmaktadır ve yüksek yüzey alanı bölü hacim oranına sahip olmaları ve eşsiz fiziksel ve kimyasal özelliklere sahip olmaları nedeniyle birçok uygulama alanında kullanılmaktadır. Geniş bant aralığına sahip yarı iletkenliği, yüksek mekanik, termal ve kimyasal kararlılığı, yüksek bağlanma enerjisi, düşük fiyatı, elektriksel, optoelektronik ve piezoelektrik özellikleri, uygun elementlerle depolandığında gösterdiği yüksek iletkenlik özellikleri, çink oksit nano yapıların çok geniş uygulama alanlarında kullanımını mümkün kılmaktadır. Uygulama alanları ile ilgili örnekler verecek olursak, çink oksit nanoparçacıklar boya yapımında boyaya koku önleyici, ultraviyole emici, antibakteriyel özellikler kazandırmaktadır. Kimya sektöründe yüzey boyaları, dokumaları ve plastik gibi malzemelere eklenen çink oksit nanoparçacıklar faydalı antibakteriyel ve mantar önleyici ajanlar olarak kullanılmaktadır. Özellikle kozmetik uygulamalarında UVA ve UVB ışınlarına karşı koruma özellikleriyle güneş kremler alanında oldukça yaygın olarak kullanım alanına sahiptir. Biosensör uygulamalarında üretilen elektrotlarda kullanılmaktadır. Yüksek izoelektrik noktaya sahip olmaları ve düşük izoelektrik noktaya sahip protein emilimi için çink oksit nanoparçacıklar uygun hale getirilmektedir. Çink oksit nanoparçacıklar elektrot malzemesi olarak boya ile duyarlı güneş pillerinde kullanılmaktadır. Felspatik cam seramikler, farklı olanlarda olmakla birlikte tüm seramiklerde temel yapı, kuvars, felspat ve kilden oluşmaktadır. Özellikle diş hekimi uygulamalarında inert olmaları, renk stabiliteleri, yüksek aşınma dirençleri ve estetik özellikleri açısından seramikler kullanılmaktadır. Sabit protezlerde estetik amaçla kullanılan tüm materyaller arasında doğal dişle renk uyumunun en iyi sağlandığı materyal seramiktir. Suyu absorbe etmemesi, ağız dokuları tarafından çok iyi tolere edilişi bu alandaki diğer çalışmalarda ışık tutmaktadır. Şekilde diş seramiğiyle yerine yerleştirilmesi hedeflenen diş gösterilmektedir. Kullanım alanlarından bahsedecek olursak, cam seramik malzemeler diş hekimi uygulamalarının yanında ayrıca ısıya dayanıklı malzemelerde, biyomedikal uygulamalarda, lazerlerde, kaplamalarda ve çok çeşitli alanlarda kullanılmaktadır. İnşaat alanında kullanılan en popüler cam seramiklerden birisi Neoperyes'tir. Mutfak gereçleri alanında cam seramikler cama kıyasla daha yüksek tokluk, estetik, çok düşük ısı genleşme katsayısı gibi özellikleri nedeniyle özellikle ocak, tencere gibi mutfak gereçleri için mükemmel bir malzeme oluşturmaktadır. Askeri alanda cam seramikler yüksek performanslı uçak ve füzelerin burunlarında kullanılmaktadır. Optik uygulamalarda da yüksek yarı saydamlık gösterdiği için ve gözenekliliğinin de kolay yok edilebilmesi nedeniyle şeffaf uygulama çalışmalarında kullanılabilmektedir. Çalışmanın amacı çink oksit nanoparçacıklarını laboratuvar ortamında sentezledikten sonra belirli oranlarda cam seramik tozu ile katkılandırarak yeni nesil bir diş seramiği üretimini gerçekleştirebilmektir. Yaptığımız deneysel çalışmalarda öncelikle nanoparçacık sentezini gerçekleştirdik. 50 mililitre saf suya 0.219 gram çinko asetat dihidrat ve 10 mililitre saf suya 0.8 gram sodyum hidroksit çözeltisi hazırlanmıştır. Yarım saat 50 santigrat derecede karıştırıldıktan sonra damla damla sodyum hidroksit çinko asetat dihidrat içerisinde pH 12 oluncaya dek ilave edilmiştir. Çözelti 2 saat daha 50 santigrat derecede karıştırıldıktan sonra 3 kez santrifüj cihazında yıkama işlemi gerçekleştirilmiştir. Son olarak etürde 24 saat 80 santigrat derecede kurutulmuştur. Şekil 5'te çinko oksit nanoparçacık sentezinde kullandığımız kimyasal çöktürme yöntemi. Diğer şekilde santrifüj cihazı, santrifüj cihazında numunelerimizin yerleştirilme şekli, santrifüj cihazında 20 dakika 3 tur şeklinde gerçekleştirmiş olduğumuz yıkama işlemi ve son olarak çinko oksit nanoparçacık sentezi sonucu etürde 80 derecede 24 saat bekletilecek numunelerimiz gösterilmiştir. Çinko oksit nanoparçacık ile felspatik cam seramik tozunun katkılandırılması. Elde edilen çinko oksit nanoparçacıklar %0.1 ile %1 aralığında 1000 mg felspatik cam seramik tozu ile aga tavanda PVA ve etil alkol ile ilave edilerek homojen bir şekilde karıştırılmıştır. perlet oluşumu, fosfatik cam seramik tozu ve zinc oksit nanoparticiklarla katkılandırılan çamur kıvamındaki malzeme preslenerek perlet formuna getirilmiştir ve 40 santigrat derece etüvde bekletilmiştir. Sentezlemiş olduğumuz çink oksit nanoparticiklar, suda çözülen toz haldeki PVA, fosfatik cam seramik tozu ve çink oksit nanopartikül karışımına eklenerek perlet oluşturulacaktır. PVA ve etil alkol eklenen karışım basınç yardımıyla perlet formunu almıştır. Perlet forma getirilen yeni nesil diş seraminin son olarak görüntüsü bu şekildedir. Karakterizasyon çalışmaları. Karakterizasyon çalışmaları kapsamında parçacık boyut analizi, zeta potansiyel analiz, X açılı kırılım analizi, eş zamanlı termal analiz, taramalı elektron mikroskobu analizi gerçekleştirilmiştir. Fosfatik cam seramik tozu için ise mikroparçacık analizi, XRD analizi, SDT analizi, SEM analizi gerçekleştirilmiştir. Çink oksitle katkılandırılarak oluşturulan cam seramik tozu karışımı ise için ise XRD ve SEM analizi yapılmıştır. Burada yıldız koymamın sebebi çalışmaların devamı ışığında TÜBİTAK'ta yapılan çalışmaların TÜBİTAK'a başvurulması öngörülmektedir. Bu sebeple yıldız koyduklarım birazdan sonuç ve tartışma kısmında grafik olarak sunulacaktır. Sonuç ve tartışma. Burada diyaliz analizi sonucu nanoparçacıkların %130 nanometre aralığına karşılık geldiği görülmüştür. Ve kırmızı, yeşil ve mavi renklerin üst üste gelmiş olması aynı boyda olduğunu ve aynı boyda olduğunu göstermektedir. Bu da sonuçların
tekrarlanabilirlik açısından demek istiyorsunuz herhalde.
Tekrarlandığı için sonuçların aynı boyda olduğunu bize sunmuş oldu.
Homojen demek değil mi hocam?
Evet. Monodispers dağılım. Sonuç ve tartışma kısmında şekilde SEM analiz görüntülerini görmekteyiz. Burada şekil 15'te çink oksit nanoparçacığın yaklaşık 70 nanometre olduğu, fosfatik cam seramik tozunun ise yaklaşık 15 mikrometre boyutlarını bize vermiş olduğunu görmekteyiz. Şekilde SDT analizlerine göre sıcaklık kütle ve sıcaklık kütle değişimi grafiklerini görmekteyiz. Burada yine SDT analizine göre faz değişimini gösteren grafik. Burada faz değişiminin 450 santigrat derecede bir faz dönüşümünü gerçekleştiğini görmekteyiz. Fosfatik cam seramik tozunun XRD analizine göre 20 ile 30 derece arasında yaklaşık 26 olduğunu düşünüyoruz. Bir pik verdiğini görmekteyiz. Çalışmalarım boyunca bana yol gösteren bilgi ve deneyimlerinden yararlandığım danışmanım doktor öğretim üyesi Ahmet Aykaca ve eş danışmanım doçent doktor Mücahit Sütçü'ye teşekkür ederim. Ayrıca çalışmalarım süresince yardımlarını ve desteğini esirgemeyen değerli arkadaşım İzel Hoka teşekkür ederim. Sizleri de dinlediğiniz için teşekkür ederim. Sorusu olan var mı?
Biz teşekkür ederiz Gizem. Güzel bir çalışma, güzel bir sunum olmuş. Eline sağlık. Başarılarınızın devamını diliyoruz. Evet, eğer sorularımız varsa süremiz dahilindeyiz. Süremiz var. Bir iki küçük soru alabiliriz. If there is any question, please go ahead, ask your question. If no, I'll continue with the next and the last presentation for this session. By the way, it was a quite productive and a nice presentation. Thank you once again. And all of the presenter attendants, this is another good point because in the first, second, and the third one, all presenter were not in the place sometimes. But during last year, everybody attending, this is awesome. This is quite nice. Thank you very much. Now, I'd like to introduce you the last presenter. Doğal liflerin özelliklerine atmosferik plazma işleminin etkileri.
Evet.
Aslı Demir ve Hüda Arattaş'tan gelen bir sunum. Buyurunuz.
Evet, merhabalar. Sesimi geliyor mu?
Duyuyor geliyor. Musun? Hoş geldiniz.
Hoş bulduk. Burada. Evet, ben kendimi tanıtayım. Benim adım Huda. Ege'de tekstil mühendislik, yüksek lisans yapıyorum. Bu yani bir derleme. Derlemenin konu duvar liflerin özelliklerine atmosferik gaz malzemenin etkileri. Bu derlemenin içeriği yani plazma nedir? Başlığında yani. Tekstil için plazma sistemi sınıflandırılması, plazma nasıl çalışır, tekstilde plazma ve kullanımları, plazma teknolojisi avantajları ve de bazı örnekler var. Bir de sonuçumuz yani özet bir şekilde bitiriyoruz. Plazma maddenin dördüncü hali olarak kabul ediliyor. Plazma ayonlar, elektronlar, serbest radikaller, fotonlar, uyarılmış ve uyarılmamış haldeki nötr atomlar ve moleküller oluşturuluyor. Fiziki kimyasal modifikasyonlardan olan plazma materyallerin temel özelliklerini değiştirmeden sadece yüzeyde çeşitli modifikasyonlar oluşmasını sağlıyor. Tekstilde sadece atmosferik basınç plazma kullanılıyor. Bu atmosferik basınç plazma 4 ana tipla oluşturuluyor. Krono deşarj, elektrik bariyer, atmosferik basınç kızdırma, deşarj, atmosferik basınçlı plazma jet. Bir de bunlar zaten farklı tipler, farklı çalışma mekanizmalardan geliyorlar. Ama genel olarak bu plazmanın yani APP yani o atmosferik basınç plazma bu şekilde çalışıyor. Resimdeki gibi ilk olarak gazlar ısıtılıyor, plazma haline geliyor. Plazma kütlesinde burası tekstil yerleştiriliyor elektrotlar arasında. Yerleştiriliyor. Sonra bu gazlar yüksek hızlı akışla şeklinde numune parçalar yönlendiriliyor. Bir de bu şekilde yüzey istediğiniz özellikler göre farklı şekillerde işleniliyor. Bu tekstilde plazma farklı kullanımlar, hidrofillik ve hidrofobik özellikler kazandırılıyor. Özellikle kaplama ve kompozit uygulamalarda adhezyon iyileştirilmesi çok önemli. Tekstil yüzeylerine istenen fonksiyonlar özellikler kazandırılması uygulanılıyor. Bir de yüzey modifikasyon son yıllarda birçok araştırmacının ilgisine çıkmıştır. Tabii bunlar hepsi çevresel endişeler nedeniyle plazma teknolojisine çok çok dikkatli bir şekilde çıkmışlar. Başka bu teknolojisinin avantajları nedir? Bu geleneksel yaş kimyasal işlemler alternatif bir ekonomik bir ekolojik bir yöntem olan plazma sadece materyallerin yüzeyinde etkili olduğu için değil, lifine temel özelliklerini bozmadan, su gerekmeden, çok az veya hiç kimyasal kullanmadan tekstil materyallerin fonksiyonellik kazandırılması, yanında işlemler esnasında herhangi bir kirlenme veya toksik atık çıkmadan çok avantajlı bir yöntemdir. Bir de bu plazma teknolojisi substratın derinliği sadece 10 nanometre veya daha az. O yüzden yüzey modifikasyon tekniği olduğunu anlamına gelir. Bunun pozitif bir yanı var. Temel özelliklerine etkilenmez ama negatif yanı vardır. Yüzey kirlenmesi plazma işlemi için zararlı olabilir. O yüzden plazma işleminden sonra tekstillerin fiziksel, kimyasal, morfolojik özelliklerinin incelenimi çok önemli. Örneklerime gelince bir çalışma yaptı, boyamak için bir ebek boyamak için onun hidrofilli özelliklerini geliştirmesi gerekiyor. Bu ebek resimdeki gibi bu işlenmemiş ebek, onun hidrofilliği çok zayıf, onun temas açısı o kadar 140 ama işledikten sonra, plazma ile işledikten sonra o kadar temas açısı artıldığı gösteriliyor. Diğer bizim başka bir örneğimiz var, hidrofillik bir ebek hidrofilliğe dönüştürülmesi. Helyum florokarbon ile işlenmiş bir ebek. Sonra SEM görüntülerine göre Bu plazma helyum florikarbon biriktikten sonra, bu tabakasını biriktikten sonra şey oldu. Yani hidrofobik bir özellikle kazandırdı. Yani mesela bu su itici ya da hastanelerden önlükler ya da böyle bir şeyler, yani mesela kan yani inmesi engellemek için yani böyle bir uygulamalardan kullanılıyor. Adazyon geliştirmesi, söylediğim gibi adazyon geliştirme yani sadece ne diyorlar, kaplamalar bir de kaplamalar bir de kompozitlerden çok önemli. Plazma ile bizim örneklerimiz burada yün liflerin adazyon geliştirmek için bir yön yapış muamele edildi. Bir de tablodaki gibi işlenmemiş bir de işlenmişle bir mukayese edildi. Yani onun ortalama biçmesi diğerlerine çok farklı. Yani hatta %100 iyileşti. Yani değerlerini çok yani yapışma değerlerini çok iyileşti. Başka bizim örneklerimize bir de özel fonksiyoneller kazandırma. Yani bir pamuk antibakteriyel etkisi kazandırmak için bir plazma ve plazma bir de nano titanyum dioksit ile işlenmiş nümune hem gram pozitif hem de gram negatif bakterilere karşı mükemmel antibakteriyel aktivite sahip olduğunu ve plazma onun aktivasyon ile %0.5 nano titanyum dioksit ile %100 ulaşabileceği gösteriliyor. Yani tablodaki gibi bizim yani plazma işlenmeden mesela onun sadece %40 ama plazma ile işledikten sonra yani onun double yani oldu. Yani 99 yani %100'e ulaşabileceği yani antibakteriyelerin özelliği çok geliştirildi. Bir de başka bir pamuk kumaşında alev geciktirici özelliklerini artırılmak için başka bir çalışma. Plazma ile nitrojen ile muamele edilmiş pamuklar bir de kumur bölümü diğerlerine tam yanmadan sonra 12'ye çıktı. Yani işledikten sonra 12'ye çıktı. İşlenmemiş pamuklar sadece %1.9 onun güçlüçürlük miktarı. Yani bizim yapacak olursa yani atmosferik basınç plazma işleme tekstilde çok önemli. Yüzeylerine çeşitli şekillerde uygulanabilmektedir ve tekstil yüzeyine istenen fonksiyonel özellikleri kazandırabiliyoruz. Örneğin yani söylediğim örnekler gibi tekstilin plazma ile işlenmesi ıslanabilirliği, boyanabilirliği, hidrofillikliği, adazyon geliştirebilirliği hep bunu bütün fonksiyonel özelliklerini iyileştirebiliyor. Tekstil maddelerinin en önemlisi yani etkilenmeden yani tekstilin lifleri ya da onun yapısı etkilenmeden kimyasal ve fiziksel morfolojik değişiklikler meydana getiriyoruz. Yani bu plazma ile. Plazma işlemler çevre dostu bir işlem ve işsiz avantajlarını sunuyor. Evet, böyle konuşmamın sonuna gelmiş. Evet, soracak bir sorular olursa alırım. Teşekkürler.
Teşekkürler Huda sunumun için. Evet, sorusu olan arkadaşlar varsa sorularımızı alabiliriz. Tekrar teşekkür ediyorum katılımınız için, bu değerli sunumlarınız için.
Benim sorum yok. Ben sadece şey söylemek istiyorum. Hani plazma teknoloji çok bildiğim bir alan değil de çok keyifle dinledim sunumunuzu. Tebrik ederim.
Rica ederim.
Sadece bunu söylemek istemiştim.
Tekrar hepinize teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Önce Türkçe sonra da İngilizce teşekkürümüzü gerçekleştirelim. Sevgili katılımcılar, bu session'ın burada sonuna gelmiş bulunuyoruz. Çok keyifliydi benim açımdan da, birçok şey öğrendim. Öğrenmenin yaşı, sınırı, Yoktur. Her zaman öğreniriz. Her insandan farklı şeyler öğrenmekteyiz zaten. Çok keyifli sunumlar hazırlamışsınız. Hepinizin eline, emeğine sağlık. Sunumlarımız sonunda bu kongremiz bittikten sonra hepinize katılım belgeleriniz hazırlandı. Hali hazırda hazır. Katılım belgeleriniz gönderilecektir. Katılım belgelerini sunacağız. Onun haricinde bizimle birlikte olduğunuz için teşekkür ediyorum ve şu anda 16-16.30 arası bir coffee break olduğunu, ondan sonra da sessionlarımızın devam edeceğini, keyifli sohbetlerin, keyifli bilimsel tartışmaların ve paylaşımların olduğu kongremizin devam edeceğini bildirmek isteriz. Yine aynı şekilde yarın da sizleri aramızda görmekten mutlu olacağız. Yarın da kongremiz devam ediyor. Tekrar teşekkürler katıldığınız için. Dear participant, I'd like to thanks once again for being with us, for participating in that valuable symposium during 21st and 21st of the May, 5th International Student Science Symposium. I'd like to remind you that our session will continue after half an hour coffee break. It will start at 4:30, and as well as we will continue with some other presentations and the sessions tomorrow as well. So please try to be with us, try to be involved, try to be participant during this two valuable International Student Science Symposium days. And I'd like to remind you once again that you will receive shortly your certificate of attendance. So we prepare the each certificate for each participant. Hopefully you enjoyed this session. Thank you very much. Have a nice day.